Namaste and a very good morning to everyone who has joined us today. I welcome you all to the weekly episodes of Dialogue with Educationists. This is one of the initiatives to have exciting discussions with educationists, parents, teachers, principals, and children across the globe on topics related to the current generation of students who are aspiring to become entrepreneurs. Today, we have a very interesting discussion on a topic, which is failure an option for your child? So without any further delays, let me introduce to you today's panelists. We have with us Mrs. Rupal Jasraj Patel. She's the founder of Only Parenting. She's a parenting expert, child psychologist, and also a counselor. We also have with us Mrs. Madhuri Duggirala, who is the Senior Director of Media Services and Operations at Google. We have with us a child, Mrs. Sanjana Dwivedi. She's a very sweet little girl. She's looking forward to become an entrepreneur in the future, and because she wants to solve the problem of depression. And she's also the part of the Metamorphosis School of Entrepreneurship. Lastly, we have with us Mr. Pawan Alaina, the founder and CEO of Metamorphosis Edu, who would be moderating the panel for us today. So without any further delays, I'm directly going to push into the topic because we're all really excited to understand how failure would really transform a child's or a parental perspective about failure. So before I begin, just a few guidelines for all the viewers and panelists. If you have any questions to the panelists, kindly put it in the Q&A section and we shall address them. So let's start today's discussion. Hand it over to you, Mr. Pawan.
Thanks, Disha. Very good morning, everyone. Good morning, panelists. Good morning, all the viewers. Very good morning. And also, today I have taken this to moderate because this is something that is very close to my heart because we always talk about the successes. For the past 5 months, we've been doing webisodes and also panel discussions, but everything was actually related to the success. We're talking about a topic and we are getting some insights on the topic. But today, I think we are all going to share our personal journeys, our failures, you know, how we had actually gone through this, and also what actually went through during our failure times. And also we are going to take insights from experts like Rupal ji here. Quickly I'll get into the discussion. I wanted to start the discussion with Sanjana, who's our student, who's aspiring entrepreneur, and I have interacted with her earlier as well. But today, I wanted to get a few insights from Sanjana. Before I get the insights, so Sanjana, how was your last 150 days? How is your lockdown times?
Hello, sir. Good morning. Yes, so I don't know. It was a really good journey, I'd say. I mean, lockdown changed my life completely. Okay. I got introduced to Metamorphosis and I'm on this journey of my entrepreneurial. So I'm quite excited. And yeah. Thanks to you all. I mean...
Yes. So, Sanjana, I mean, what's
your aspiration? Quite delighted to be here and talk to you.
Yeah. So, you said, you wanted to become an entrepreneur, but, what aspired you, what inspired you, or what motivated you to take up that journey?
Okay. So, I've seen all my people, I mean, my friends, my close relatives, people who are close to me, basically, and myself personally, I went through a really bad phase. And, I wanted to do something about that. And my idea was something which no one had ever heard of. Or, main thing is about mental health. People go through it, but one never talks about it. So that's a really sad part, So I thought I would do something on this. And entrepreneur is the best field I could get in. And... Yeah. No, I chose, I decided that moment that I'd go for this. So,
yeah. I'll quickly get into
my
that.
Experiences, my surrounding, that made me feel.
Yes, basically your, surroundings and, you have identified certain problems and you wanted to come up with a solution for that. I'll talk about your journey more in detail in the next round of discussion. So anyways, thanks for introducing and... Now I wanted to, discuss with Madhuri ma'am. Very good morning. So how was your last 150 days, ma'am? How was working from home?
I would say initially it was challenging because I was so used to a routine of 8 to 5. I was at work, my kids at school, my husband at office. And I would say first few weeks was really hard balancing kids online schools and my own job. But I've always believed that there's a solution to everything. So like Sanjana was saying, within 2-3 weeks, I figured out how do you make the best of the lockdown. Like as a working mom, I've never spent this much time with my kids around. So I thought, let me be optimistic about it. Yes. We figured out a way what meetings my kids can come and see, even my executives, and they were fine with it so that they come in and out of the meetings as well.
Yes.
But I think it taught a lot of things on how do you build that resilience to overcome an adversity like this and still be grateful to what we still have.
Yes, ma'am. So you have two kids. I mean, Nirvan and Moksha, both have, we have personally interacted, you know, they both have amazing ideas. They have got amazing aspirations. So, I mean, what was your contribution to that? I mean, did you spend a lot of time with them? Because you said, you know, your job is from say 8 to 5 or 8 to 6. So you are a working mom. And how could you even, you know, motivate them to come up with ideas? How much time did you spend with them so far?
Yeah, I think firstly, I've learned early on as a working mother that quality is more important than quantity. So I made sure that I spend quality time. Sometimes probably I wouldn't have spent more than a couple of hours in the evening, but the time was, I make sure there's no distractions. There are no laptops or phones around me. Second, I believe parenting is not about preaching. Parenting is about being who you are, and kids just look at you like a hawk. I think you just role model them. I think 2-3 things. I came from a very lower middle class family. Many people have helped me to be where I am in my education. So they have seen me always doing a lot of social work or a lot of things for others to make world or everybody else around you a better place. So I'll just share a small story. One day I came home and my daughter told me, "Mom, I did something. I hope you're okay with this." Somebody came and asked for a charity, 100 rupees. And my nanny apparently asked her, "Why don't you call mom and take permission?" She said, "No, I'm very sure my mom is okay. This is my pocket money and I'm giving it to benefit somebody else." And she's given that to us. So I think they've eventually being around us, they've learned a lot of what we can do. Two, although people talk a lot about corporates, how intense and hectic it is, corporates have taught me a lot. And day in and day out, I'm working for Google now, before I was with Microsoft. So they've seen my journey in corporates, and sometimes when they hear me solving certain challenges, I think they're inspired that big organizations or small organizations, you can do something to the world. I feel hopefully that has made small difference in their lives.
Yes. So you talk about work with them, ma'am. I mean, do you talk about work? I mean, what has happened in the office, or do you discuss with them on what is happening on their day-to-day basis? So what kind of interactions that actually goes with your kids?
So for good or bad, both of them are very curious. And I'm actually more worried sometimes that they know more about Google and Salesforce. My husband works for Salesforce. And I have also believed that it's important for children to know what we do at work. So sometimes I do discuss, I mean, because of confidentiality, I don't tell everything, but I tell the gist of it. Look, I'm solving something, like we have a vision and we are like, you know, figuring out goals and we're not going through it. Some days I have hard days. Some days I'm also exhausted and maybe I'm going through a tough situation. I realized, and I tried Pawan once or twice by not telling them, they won't understand why is mommy like this? Like, why is she not bubbly like usually? So I realized it's better to share your journey with them. Look, today has been a tough day and here are a few things we are trying to do. So they know a lot about what, at least in a headline, they can say what we do at work. And then I feel that enables dialogue. Like, I'll be honest, there are times I feel guilty about not spending time. So I used to feel it within myself. So 2 years ago, I decided, why don't I have a conversation with them? I said, "Hey, I just came back from London. I have to tell you, I missed you when I was in London for a week. And there are days I really miss you. And I'm not sure if, like, you know, so much of work, but I'm ambitious. I like this." Immediately, my daughter asked me, "Mom, is this an issue or is it a dilemma?" If it's a dilemma, don't worry. I think, like, you know, we find you as an insight. And I think an 8-year-old asking me, "Is it an issue or a dilemma?" really made me think, yeah, it's not an issue. It's just a dilemma I go through. My son didn't say anything at that time, But later, an hour later, when we are playing cricket, he just, I mean, he has this humor of different way of expressing things. Yes. And he said, look, just in case you are planning to quit, please don't do so. Please realize you're working for one of the famous companies in the world. Uh-huh. Yes, we do miss you sometimes. But yeah, like this, you make up time, you do like, you know, and we have family as well. So we have a huge support system between me and my husband. And it's good. I really learned the power of having a dialogue. Kids are no longer younger these days. Like even a young child, and they can give you a good advice. And I'd say that gave me a lot of confidence that like, you know, it's better to be authentic, transparent with them.
I think we should thank Google for that. You know, a lot of exposure that kids are getting because of Google, or, you know, the kind of news that they see these days. I think media is actually impacting a lot in the student's perspective. And so I'll come back to you on, you know, more about, you know, your parenting and also, you know, how your kids are actually thinking. So I would like to welcome Rupal ma'am. A very good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, ma'am. So, you know, you are an accomplished, you know, psychiatrist, and, you know, you've been interacting with a lot of parents on a day-to-day basis. So, you know, I wanted to just, before I get there, you know, how was your last 150 days? Now that, you know, you've been working from home, so what kind of counselings that are happening through online?
So lots of it online. In fact, I think it's probably, especially like with corporates, when you say it's increased because a lot of parents are facing challenges with working from home. So I think the corporates are having more and more sessions to empower the parents.
Yeah,
and I think for me, just generally, like, you know, I think as what Madhuri also shared, it's actually been a very great journey. It's actually of a lot of growth, a lot of reflection, you know, a lot of gratitude for so many things. You know, I think this whole pandemic has come to kind of get the world on a reset mode, like everybody to look within, and it's a great time to grow, you know, as people or in whichever field you are. But I think it's a wonderful, of course there are challenges, but yes, you know, we can like I tell the parents in all the workshops that either, you know, you can live in fear and you know, pass that anxiety to your kids, or you can live with that wisdom of yes, you have to take precautions, we are facing this, and whatever is in our hands, we can deal with it. You know, we can't you know, there's no point stressing and getting anxious and getting worried till there is something to worry about.
So
even at that time, you should be worried.
So getting into the discussion, ma'am, I mean, what, according to you, is failure? I mean, how do you define failure? I mean, you know, out of your experience or something, you know, is there any expectation that you put, and if at all you're not meeting the expectation, then you will define failure, or how do you define failure?
So I define failure as an opportunity. I think failure is the greatest opportunity that you can have. You know, it's not an absence or a lack of being successful. Failure is just a stepping stone to success, right? It's just an experience on the path to success. And without challenges, you can't grow. You know, when you're living a life which is of ease, there is no growth happening because there is no reflection happening. You're not even challenging that part of yourself or bringing out that capability in yourself, which you probably didn't know existed because there's no challenge to deal with. You know, so failure actually is the greatest opportunity for growth in every way.
Very, very interesting insight that we got. I mean, failure is an opportunity. I think all the viewers that we are watching, I mean, we have got amazing insight from Rupal ma'am, saying that, you know, failure is an opportunity, and also, you know, very famous saying, you know, failure is the stepping stone of success. I think with this note, you know, I wanted to get into the discussion. Again, I'll get back to Sanjana. So Sanjana, I mean, you know, you've been working on several ideas, right? I mean, which grade are you in currently?
I'm in 12th now.
Yeah, Sanjana, you are in 12th. So, So what are your quick objectives? Yes. And do you consider that, you know, I'll be failing if at all I'm not considering, I mean, I'm not reaching certain objectives. So do you have such objectives that you've already set up, especially when you're in 12th, you know? We'll be having a lot of objectives. So. Yes. Can you mention?
So you mean long-term goals and short-term goals, for example?
Short-term goals, yeah. You can talk about certain short-term goals.
Yeah, yes. So basically, I think right now my focus would be on boards.
Board examinations.
Yeah. Okay. After, I mean, obviously boards right now, once I'm good at, I have other long-term goals too.
All right. So board exams is something that you have, and also, yeah. Do you have any milestone that you wanted to cross, say 95%, 98% or 99%?
Yeah, anything else? Obviously expectations from parents, from teachers. I mean, those expectations are a big load.
So,
95.
So if at all you're getting below 95, say 93.5%, if at all you get, do you consider yourself as a failure?
No, not at all.
Okay.
If I tried enough, if I worked hard, I would call myself.
Yes. And is your mom okay with it? If at all you're getting less than 95%?
I think.
She's right beside you now.
I'll talk to her. I'll tell her, I'll explain her. I worked hard.
Yeah.
And if that's not the case.
Correct. All right. So basically what you're trying to say is, even if at all you're not reaching 95% or any milestone that you have set up, if at all you try enough, I think that itself is a success for you. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
The thing is, if I don't give up,
yeah,
I work hard, then I wouldn't consider it as a failure.
All right. Thank you. I'll get back to you again. We'll discuss about your boards more, because you are in 12th, you know, it's very interesting stage that you are in now, so we'll discuss on that.
I know.
Okay. So again, Madhuri ma'am, so, you know, Nirvan and Moksha, do you set up any milestones for them, or do they come up with the milestones to you? So how does it happen? I mean, how do you set up few targets for them?
Yeah, actually, before I answer this question, I thought for the audience, I'll say some caveats and some context based on which all my answers can be interpreted. Okay. I think one is, personally, I feel there is nothing right or wrong, good or bad in parenting journey. Every child is unique. Every parenting journey is unique. So a lot of what I share is from my journey. So it will help in the context as well. And second is, like, more than parenting a child or, like, you know, making them child, I've realized, and my twins are 10 years old now, a lot of my beliefs also, parents' beliefs are inflicted on the children as well. So I thought I'd share my own beliefs, which I think what I do in my journey will help. I think I moved away from the traditional definitions of success and failure. If you go and search for a dictionary definition of failure, it says lack of success. And I've always felt, if success is defined by others in the society, then that is not your own success. It is a success defined by somebody else. So I would say 10, 15 years ago, I've learned this both in my personal, professional life, and that helps me in my parenting as well, is don't let others define your success. You have your dreams. You have whatever means success to you. Set those goals. Okay. And there is a difference between, while it sounds like an English grammar teacher saying, but there's a difference between failing and failure. We continuously fail at things. If you're not failing, then you're not setting ambitious goals in your personal, professional life. So you have a goal, you may fail at it, but that doesn't make you a failure. For me, failure happens only if you lose determination and you give up things. Everything else, in my opinion. So eventually, I moved on to this world called learning. Now, life for me is not about success or failure. Life is always about a bunch of lessons and learning. Now, with that as a context, Pawan, that's a great question. I think more than milestones, I keep asking them regularly, at this point in life, what does success mean to you? What does happiness mean to you? I'm also a big believer in children being happy, having physical, mental, emotional well-being as well. So a lot of more than milestones, we actually tell them to enjoy their journey. But I probably ask them to set up small goals than milestones. See, milestones are outcomes. But I tell them, what's your goal? Like in this next 3 months, or let's say you have 1 week holiday now, is there something you would like to accomplish? And I'm sure they may be watching the live stream now, so they'll hear some of my tricks, which I don't share with them. But sometimes I intentionally make them set a larger goals or sign up for these competitions, which are really hard, because I want them to experience what it feels like not reaching that. Like, let's say you joined a competition and you haven't like, you know, been in the top three of like an art competition or a literary fest, or sometimes you've set a goal and you didn't complete as well. So those are the things I keep trying. More than a milestone, I'm asking them to set a goal and making them experience. They won't reach milestones or goals sometimes. And then I want to observe what goes on in them and then be there as a guide.
Yes, yes. I'll get there, ma'am. I've got very interesting point out of this, because acceptance of failure is something that I wanted to discuss with you in the next round. Because, you know, you've been saying that, you know, everyone has their own way of, you know, defining a success or failure. But, you know, I wanted to discuss on, you know, acceptance of failure. This is a very interesting insight that you have shared. Thank you so much for that. Again, Rupal ma'am, you know, talking about Madhuri ma'am's, you know, pointers, how is the happiness quotient measured? I mean, you know, in general, will it vary from an individual to individual happiness quotient, or together, how do we achieve as a community a certain happiness quotient? Because I have seen certain nations, instead of, you know, talking about GDP or something, they're actually talking about, you know, their happiness quotient.
Like Bhutan.
Yeah.
Bhutan that judges the economy by happiness.
Yes, yes. So as a community, you know, how do we arrive at that point, or I mean, under happiness quotient, you know, what are things that we need to go through as an individual? How can we measure our happiness quotient?
So I think happiness is, first of all, an inner thing, right? It's not, it's happiness is not actually dependent on anything outside. It's when you are happy that you can transform things around you. So the key to happiness is, you know, to be happy in the midst of your challenges also. To actually not feel that pain and that anxiety and that like stress or worry or any of the negativities. That is actually when you know, and of course it's a struggle. It's not an easy thing, right? To keep feeling when things are going wrong, or to keep not letting that, I practice Buddhism, so, you know, not letting your life state shake inside, right? So, happiness is an inner work. It's inner job. Nobody can make you happy. You can't give happiness to someone. But, you know, you can empower them towards happiness. You can, especially with parents and kids, or with teachers and kids, you know, how can, you know, look at the positive side of a situation. Because at that age, that's the way you're going to cultivate it, to cultivate that kind of growth mindset. Like, you know, nothing is... it's not the end. Nothing is final. There's always hope.
Yeah.
You know, when you cultivate that hope and that strength within, I think happiness kind of just follows, right? Because when you have hope, you're always looking towards a solution rather than focusing on what is wrong and what is the problem.
Correct.
You know, so how to develop that kind of mindset through, you know, whether it's boosting self-esteem, whether it's encouragement, you know, encouraging them in different ways, whether it is like Madhuri shared, you know, setting goals. Because the accomplishment of that goal will boost that self-esteem, which will make them feel happy. Right? So it is very, there are lots of small ways in which it can be done, as long as you're focusing on empowering the child.
Yes.
You know, your whole intent to do that activity or have that conversation is, I want to leave this child a little bit more empowered, feeling a little bit more good about themselves. Because, you know, the purpose of education or the purpose of anything in life is happiness.
Yes.
So am I dealing with everything focused that is this eventually leading to happiness? Or am I focusing on, am I getting this child to listen to me and obey me right now? Right? More often that is the mindset, rather than realizing that, you know, even discipline, the purpose of discipline is to teach my child.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
So when, and like, you know, how Sanjana shared that she doesn't think she's going to feel like a failure. She gets 93.5, right? Because clearly her self-esteem is good enough. You know, she is her happiness or her definition of herself, you know, or her self-esteem is not based on those marks that are coming.
Correct.
Which is why to get to that path of happiness is going to be easier for her.
Correct. Absolutely right. I mean, accomplishment of a goal, you know, I think that gives a lot of happiness. In fact, you know, what I actually do every day, morning when I wake up, you know, I put my own checklist, you know, as soon as I get up, you know, I need to clean my tennis racket, for example, you know, that is my, you know, I love my tennis racket. So I just clean it every day. You know, it gives me a lot of happiness. It gives me a very good positive vibe for my rest of the day. Likewise, I think, you know, small accomplishments is something definitely it will lead to, you know, the happiness
Also, especially during this lockdown, you know, there's one thing I tell parents is, especially with even the younger kids or older kids, give them things. You know, everybody is facing lack of domestic staff, you know, working from home, kids have online. There's so many things happening. So everybody contributing. So if you give that child also a kind of a thing to do in the house, and this is your responsibility, you know, whether it is laying the table, clearing the table, washing the dishes, it can be anything, big or small. But that also will give them, they may moan and groan and complain about it. And I'm sure a lot of students who are watching are going to think that, oh no. But somewhere that is going to give them that feeling of, you know, I have done this and I am contributing. And that also will lead to that boosting of that self-esteem. You know, to correct. Feel good about yourself that I also making a difference in some way.
Yeah. Very interesting. Thank you so much for the insight, ma'am. I mean, small accomplishments. I think the checklist is one of the things that we should follow to measure our happiness quotient. Again, I'm getting back to Madhuri ma'am. So because of this COVID-19, everyone is watching us. I mean, at least at our homes, you know, people. The kids are watching parents. So they're watching on a day-to-day basis. So do you even get a thought that if at all my kids watch me as a failure, for example, whatever I wanted to achieve, say, for example, I wanted to do some charity work, but I couldn't do, then my kids might think that, you know, I'm a failure. So as a parent, do you get such thoughts that, you know, I shouldn't fail in front of my kids?
So actually, thanks for asking that question. I'll say the short answer and then a long answer as well. I think the answer is no. I mean, okay. I think failure is inevitable in life. And then life is a change. Things go wrong. Things move on. And if I'm setting ambitious goals, let's say charity or something like that, the failure has to come. So I'd rather want my children to see me as a normal human being. That your mom also goes through all these things. She also experiences. But one thing I've learned, Pawan, is how I learned to cope up with my disappointments or things when I couldn't handle. Is also an example, I feel, for your own kids. Like, and I've seen two, three things coming, right? One is accepting sometimes that, oh, I'm like, I couldn't do it. I feel so disappointed. But, you know, I've done this once before, so I'm going to try it again and I'm going to do it better next time. So two things I realized is, one is, how do you handle your own disappointments with grace? Or are you making a big chaos at home? Oh my goodness, every time I do this phone call, I'm cursing this person. I'm like, I left this there. Then they show that you don't have your own emotions in check, first of all. Correct. Second, I realize some powerful phrases, of course, they have to be authentic and real, will also help. Like sometimes saying things like, look, I'm so sorry. I could have done this so differently. I own it up and I'm going to do this differently. And I've learned this one lesson. And I've learned to ask this question every time to myself. And I share it explicitly. You know, this happened to me. The one lesson I learned from this is this. So I'm going to do it better. The three things I try to leave for such things is, want them to know this is real. Don't expect that there is success coming every time. But things happen. Things go wrong. Failures, mistakes happen. But I take ownership. Here are two things I'm going to try again. So that I feel that may leave them with a little bit of excitement that, yeah, this is normal. It'll happen to me. If it happens to my mom, it'll happen to me. If she can deal with it, I can also deal with it. So I think that's what I feel is helpful. I didn't want to ever set up that everything is hunky-dory and rosy in life. I'd rather make them see my journey.
Right. I mean, this has happened to me as well. I mean, when I was in the school, when I used to ask my father to buy, say, tennis rackets or, so many things. You know, whenever he used to say no, you know, I used to think that, you know, he's a failure because, when my friends are, coming in, very posh cars and all, when I go normally to the school, I always think that he's my father, a failure. I used to think that. But later, when I have started earning or when I started living by myself, then I actually understood that, living by yourself or say getting so many things realized. I mean, what is necessary, what is not necessary, when I'm actually trying to prioritize success, defining what is success, defining what is failure. Then I actually understood, actually my father has actually done much better than what I'm doing now. So that's what, that realization is coming. But I think the realization for this generation, I think it is going to come much more faster, because they are actually closely watching the parent on a regular basis, because you know a lot of interactions that keeps happening, and you know the kids are actually discussing about Swiggy, they are talking about Ola, they are talking about Uber with the parents. So I think this generation is actually blessed to have parents like you all.
I think they have so much of exposure now, Pawan, and like Miss Rupal was also mentioning the word growth mindset, right? I think if they give up their fixed mindset and they're into this growth mindset all the time, I think they'll also realize that you can absolutely, like, you know, have a strategy, figure out how to make things happen for you all.
Correct. Yes. Yes. Very interesting. I mean, I'll get there. Now we'll talk to our 12th grader, Sanjana. Again, I'm reminding you, our boards are coming, Sanjana. So, okay. I wanted to, you know, ask you, you know, Sanjana, so what is one thing that you always expect from your mom? I mean, because you are in 12th, what kind of conversations that you expect from your mom, and what kind of conversations that happens?
Okay, I expect her to scold me, and, you know, to keep cutting. I mean, mom never did that. I'm really glad. I'm really happy. I don't expect her to keep telling me, you can't do this, you can't that, you know, stopping me from doing this. I mean, okay, tell me if it's wrong. Give me your perspective. But when I'm sad or I'm not feeling good or I'm not performing well, you know, I expect her to come talk to me, ask me what's going on.
Yes.
And that's it. Actually, my mom's a teacher.
Yes.
And
yes.
She's my best friend. Trust me. I mean, I share everything with her, literally. We're best friends. So, you know, we never had that problem. I was so open to my mom that she started sharing things with me. So we had that mutual understanding.
Yeah.
So that was a good thing. So I expect every child to share things with their parents.
Yes.
Because they don't know how you feel.
Correct.
You have to share, you have to open up. So I'd say that.
Interesting. So basically you share everything with your mom, and is there any failure of yours that you have recently shared with your mom? See, failure could be as simple as, you know, you have participated in any of the competition or a tournament and you could not, you know, get the winner's title or the runner-up title. So anything that has happened recently, and you know, what is the best insight that you have got so far?
Yeah, so what happened, my mom was always open about everything. So, I mean, she never said that, why did you do so bad? Why did you get... What happened recently is, you know, there's a lot of problem in my personal life, my academics, everything all together.
Yeah.
You know, so I couldn't open up anyone.
Okay.
So I sat with her. I told, see, I failed at this. I didn't do well at this. I didn't want to hide it with you. Even in academics, I didn't get good in a particular subject.
Yes.
So I didn't have feeling ki, you know, she'll scold me, she'll hit me, she'll do this, she'll do that. I mean, I opened up. I said, see, I didn't do this time. I'll do good next time. So please don't lose that expectation or hopes from me. Don't be sad.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you have that insecurity that, you know, your mom might lose hopes or expectations.
I mean, who doesn't? Obviously, yes. we have to fulfill, we have to reach those expectations. No matter what, that is in blood. Indian culture is the more.
Okay, such a big statement, but yes. Okay. we'll discuss on that. Yes, you are saying something.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's it. I am insecure, but I'm also not worried. I have made up my mind that, okay, it's fine. I have to accept this failure, as ma'am said, you know. Success comes from your experiences. And those experiences comes from your failures. So you need to have failures in your life. I don't like, why did I do this? Why did I fail like this? I move on. I feel like, okay, it happened. Fine. Next time I won't do this. So I won't do that.
All right.
So I have that mindset.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing, Sanjana. I think good that, you know, you're very open with your mom, and I'm sure that, you know, you share a very good rapport with your mom, and I think that's helping you a lot. Anyways, so Rupal ma'am, I mean, you know, talking about this topic, you know, is failure an option for your kids? Now there are a lot of principals that are also watching our session live. So is there any message or a suggestion that you want to give it to all the principals out here on, you know, how they can actually celebrate failures as well? Celebrate in the sense, at least, how can they actually talk about failures as well in their own schools? Because school is the place where, you know, a lot of competitions take place. You know, there is a lot of competitive spirit amongst the students. So to regulate that well, you know, is there any message that you can share with our principals out here?
I think one is to, you know, recognize that first every child is different, right? And there is nobody who is perfect, and everybody is different in different ways. You know, each person will have their own strengths. So if we can actually focus on recognizing the strength of each child rather than putting them in compartments that, you know, if academic or music or, you know, it's everyone will have different strengths, right? Yeah. Also, to, you know, the whole key to success should be to become better than what I was yesterday.
Yes.
You know, if I'm becoming better than what I was yesterday, there is no scope of not. And even if I didn't do it, the fact that I'm going to get up and try again, that itself is overcoming failure. That itself is not leading, becoming a failure, right? Because yes, I may have failed. I may fail 10 times, but I'll get up the 11th time. The key to overcoming it and transforming it is persevering. So if kids can be taught to persevere, like, you know, again, earlier how we spoke about goals, set a goal. And if I don't achieve the goal, I will keep persevering till I get it, you know, or keep improving myself and keep growing in whatever way I need to grow to get there. And even if I don't want that goal, that's fine too. I can set a new goal, right? But somewhere, not with escaping that, oh, I can't do this goal, or because that is, I'm not believing in myself, so I don't want it. That it should not be that. So again, that will be a very individual case-to-case situation, right? So I think the whole way to help kids overcome failure is to build their self-esteem, is to encourage them, is to focus on their strengths, you know, to help them develop this growth mindset, help them become more resilient, help them develop that habit of persevering, you know, and not just giving up. Because staying undefeated and not giving up itself is success. That itself is already a path to victory.
Yes.
You know, so if that is what can be inculcated, and also I feel in a lot of schools, sometimes there is, you know, people who have done well is okay. I mean, you're celebrating that, but a lot of people, a lot of schools and colleges, they call out also everybody's marks. Yes. You know, again, that is, why is a student have to be defined only by marks? Like I said, everybody is different. That child may be the best in another sport if you put them, or put them in cookery, or maybe the best at humanity. You know, just being sensitive to another person. There can be so many qualities. But when we compartmentalize it, and of course, I know schools have to do grading and marking, but it doesn't need to be done at the cost of, announcements don't have to be done at the cost of pulling somebody down. Yes, you raise people who are doing well, but don't pull down the others by making, okay, you did so badly, or reprimanding them in front of. Because, you know, at some point, I feel the kid, when that self-esteem goes down, you just want to give up. Like, this teacher doesn't see anything good in me. And if I can't do after so much effort, what's the point of trying only? So before even trying, that child has already stopped.
Yes. Yes. Is there any way to monitor this, ma'am? I mean, because see, every child is having a special attribute. So, I mean, is there any way to monitor for a school that, say, even if at all he or she is not good at academics, you know, how could we recognize the talent of the children? Because I'm talking about the volumes here.
So I think it's only, you know, you can only recognize it on a one-to-one basis. So that's why parents play a very big role. Teachers play a very big role, who are in the classrooms and who are interacting with kids. You know, if the focus of the teacher is not just to teach the academics, but to also build that bond, you know, maybe the I don't know, the initial class or the first, you know, I think a lot of schools are doing that, right? They have icebreaker sessions. So you're getting to, because it's always a genuineness of wanting to know and nurture that child. And when you have that, that's why you will see there are some teachers who will know every child's name, no matter how many divisions they teach. Because somewhere they have been actually recognizing that child. They're not looking at it as one person just sitting in my class and I'm just giving my lecture. Right? That's the difference I feel between a teacher who is passionate about educating the child or fostering the child versus someone who's doing it. And I think there are more and more who are becoming aware. And I mean, you know, I kind of do sometimes sessions for teachers also. And the whole focus to how to, you know, the same thing what I do for parents is how do you, you know, encourage children. We very often parents and teachers don't even realize they are discouraging a child, you know, and they are discouraging through words, through body language. And sometimes they may think that that is encouragement also. You know, like they may say, oh, you know, but they won't, you know, next, you, I'm sure you can do better than this. You know, so you feel, oh, I'm saying, you're sure you can do better, but that's not encouragement because somewhere it feels I'm not good enough. So there are a lot of ways to encourage. So, you know, I think that is something and a ways to build the child's self-esteem, ways to develop that growth mindset and that, you know, emotional quotient that we keep hearing about. Those are very important aspects. Because those are going to help you deal with all these other challenges that you face in life.
Yeah. Yeah. Very interesting insights, man. Thank you so much for that. I think you have given amazing insights on, you know, how do we focus on the strengths of the students and also, you know, how to encourage the kids or encourage in a very, you know, polished way is something that is very interesting. We'll take insight from Madhuri ma'am also on this. So ma'am, I mean, I wanted to know about, you know, how do you encourage, you know, your children? I mean, in what way do you encourage? I mean, do you buy something for them? Do you motivate so that, you know, they'll get encouraged? Or what is your way of encouraging, you know, your kids?
Yeah, firstly, thanks, Ms. Rupal and Sanjana. I think it was great hearing your insights. So I'll just build on what they both have shared. I think the first thing is, I think it's important to be a child's guide and not savior. Like, don't solve all the problems for them, but just be the guide along with them. And I can't agree. Second point is, I can't agree with what most Ms. Rupal said is, observe the process. I think parents have the luxury, right? Your child is one-on-one. So observe the process, ask them the questions. What are you feeling? How did you feel? And things like that. Because then you can relay that to the teacher. And I think we can play a huge role as a parent. Third is, I think compliments and praise is good, but I think lavish and overpriced sometimes makes children feel that only when they get validated by others, only if somebody is praising, then everything is good. So somewhere I think that balance of, look, overcoming adversity is also good, but you don't have to be told by others that you are great all the time. And I do this at my work as well. As a leader, I tell everybody, look, my job is to give you a performance rating. But don't let a rating define your worth. Similarly, don't let a marks define your worth. I think it's important for us as parents and professionals to do this. I think the next is teach kids to delay gratification a little bit. Many times they say, I want cupcakes. I want A, B, C, or can we buy this? Can we do this? I realized that if you delay gratification, that moment they have to learn how to self-control, how to do things. Exactly when you said, Pavan, when we were young, when you ask something to your mom or dad, you would get after a couple of months more because of the affordability and others. But today we are all successful in our own ways today because that gratification helped us. We know how to wait. We just are not easily disappointed by things and things like that. And I feel like ma'am said, I model persistence a little bit. Like persistence, resilience, managing your emotions are very important even tomorrow when you grow up. Like at work, as much as my IQ helps me, what helps me even more is how do you manage your emotions? How much resilience and persistence do I have to do things? I'd say, and lastly, I've realized, create some safe spaces for learning at home. Teach your kids how to fail. Don't keep on telling them, like our goal is to say succeed, succeed, succeed. But I think it's important. Create some places. I'd recommend one book to everybody that has definitely changed my way of thinking. How to Measure Your Success by Clayton Christensen. He's a Harvard professor. I bought it so that I thought it'll be useful for me. When I turned 30, I thought, let me define how do I measure my success. But he gave a lot of tips even for parenting. And that's when I learned, apart from schools, as a parent, I can also create a learning school, create safe space where they can fail. They can do a few things and learn to bounce back what it feels. So those are a few things I am trying as a parent.
Correct. Correct. So basically what you're trying to say is, ma'am, so, you know, failure is an option for your kids, right? I mean, but how do you ensure that, you know, they're bouncing back, or, you know, from it? Because one thing you see, like, we're all talking about, yes, failures are fine, but how do you ensure that the learning is happening out of the failure? I mean, are you there throughout the failure is happening, that process?
So I found a few moments. Firstly, I'll completely say failure has to be an option, not only an option. It's not even a question, I would say. We have to make our kids taste failure, and like, it is in our hands and everything else. Yeah. What I realized is, when you observe your child, every child is unique. At least I can share my experience. There are certain moments when they're very lost, when they're absolutely, that is the time I think you have to recognize, have a dialogue with them. And most of you who have slightly older kids, you know, they won't open up the moment you go and say, hey, what happened? Is everything all right? Next minute, they're not going to come up with, mom, these are the three things. So sometimes you have to give them space. Okay, I'll come back later. Tell me when you're ready. But I think you have to spot the time when sometimes they are okay. They'll say, mom, I think I'll handle it. Don't worry. Leave them alone. It's okay. But there are times when they're not open. If they're visibly upset, you see they are lost. That's the time I feel you be there and tell them, look, I'm here for you. Like, please ask questions. But at that time, you need to know as a parent, when is it you will have to involve. Having said that, I also say this, that there are times your child is in danger. There are times I think your child is going through tremendous humiliation or others. And that's not the time to say they'll figure it out themselves. Like, one example I can share is, I've seen it in school once with another child. The child is going through tremendous humiliation because he or she forgot some costume at home. Now, that's not the time to teach your child a responsibility and say, this is what I say responsibility. Why did you forget? You should have slept early, woken up. Like, take the child out of the humiliation at that point of time. Help them later. So I think it's a balance. Sometimes go in and have a conversation, and sometimes be there so that they will come out of it, so that it doesn't affect them adversely.
Yes, yes.
But in the end, I would just say, I am learning this, and I'd request all the parents to do this, is if your mindset for failure changes, actually you will enable your kids to take more risks, enjoy the failure, celebrate failures, and taste the journey along.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much for your insight. I mean, I think it's a very good parenting tip that you have given, and I'm glad that, you know, you're actually, along with, you know, talking, defining success or failure, you're also actually talking about the entire process of the failure, you know, how they're actually coming out of the failure and how they're actually learning. That observation is something that is, I think, very much required. Thank you so much for that. We will take, you know, quick questions from the audience now. And, you know, and then we'll have a closing remarks. I think we have a student, Kritik. He's asking, are failures good or bad depending in their severity and or how it is a failure? So we'll ask Rupal ma'am to take this question. So Rupal ma'am, so we have a student asking, you know, are failures good or bad depending in their severity?
No, I mean, the severity or not, there is nothing good or bad, right? It's not black and white.
Yes.
You know, so failure is, if you look at it as, oh my God, it's a failure, it's bad, whether it's big or small. But if you look at the biggest failure also, that this is an opportunity for me to grow, you know, what went wrong that I can change it and I can come out of this, to have that conviction in the depth of my life that I am going to change this situation. You know, and the power is there. I have it, you know, I will be able to do. Maybe it didn't work out this time. Maybe I'll find another way to make it work. Or maybe I'll pursue something else which will work, you know, depending on what the situation is. So it can't be, you know, on, like, oh my God, this, there is nothing that is the end. You know, there is nothing which is so drastic that it is over. You know, like, till you have life, till then you have hope. So there is nothing which is ever so severe that you can't transform it or overcome it.
All right. Yes. Yes. Thank you for that. So, I mean, again, I mean, adding to that question, I mean, how do we prioritize? I mean, because as a kid, you know, I think they are going to prioritize that, you know, say, for example, Sandhina, now she's actually prioritizing boards as her main thing. So if at all she is failing in the sense, I mean, if at all she is getting 93.5%. So since the severity of it is going to be so high, do you think that, you know, the impact will be longer because of the severity is high? Or how do we...
I think the impact is again dependent on your perspective. It is a glass half empty, half full. Am I going to look at it as half full? Or am I going to look at it as half empty? Am I going to look at it the next time I can fill it completely? Yes, okay, now the severity has happened. Is there anything I can do to change it? No, the marks have come, the exams are done. Now what do I do? Now what is the best path open for me? If I keep looking back and I keep saying, I wish I would have done this, or I wish I'm just going to pull myself down. So yes, there is going to be a moment, or a lot of moments where you don't feel good about it. But you have to also at that point of time, stop and see what is in my power. I can't change the past. I can't go back and give the exam. So what is it that I can do? I'd rather focus on what I can do instead of wasting so many moments worrying about what I can't. And in that moment, what I can do, to actually use that as an opportunity. Because see, if I don't use that as an opportunity to reflect that, okay, maybe I didn't study enough. Maybe I should become more disciplined with my work. Maybe I didn't give my 100%. You know, if those are things at all. Or maybe I did give my 100%. Like as Sanjana said, if you give your 100%, you will also not feel it that, okay, you know, everybody can't be good in everything. And maybe this is not a field which is, I know academically it bothers me, but I'm very good at cooking. I'm very good at art. I'm very good at music, you know. So to actually recognize what your own strengths are also. Because when you actually recognize your strengths, when you actually, think about what your good qualities are also. And that's why a supportive adult at those times is very, very important. You know, whether it's a parent or a teacher or a mentor or whoever, but a supportive person becomes very important. That is why, like in the beginning, I told you, it's more about the parents than the kids when they're dealing with failure, of how they've nurtured, fostered, raised, and how they're going to support and guide them through this journey.
Yes.
Because failure is inevitable. It is going to happen in life to all of us.
Yes. Yes. Correct. Thank you. Thank you so much for your insight, ma'am. I think... we have another question from Srinivas Mantha from Qatar. He's asking, do defining objectives in terms of time becoming a limiting factor, thus enhancing failure? So, Madhuri ma'am, your perspective on this. So, what he's asking is, probably you're defining objectives in terms of time becoming a limiting factor and thus enhancing failure, or you're giving space to the failure there because the time limits are coming in between.
Good question, Srinivas. Thanks for asking. I'll tell you both perspectives, pros and cons of it. I think the advantage of defining a goal and associating a time with it, I think just as human beings, we have a tendency to prioritize, put a strategy, put a plan around it. So when there is, let's say, an aspiration, I'm going to tackle this goal in the next quarter or 2 quarters or 1 year, I think we may work towards a good streamlined prioritization timeline. I think those are the advantages of it. But having said that, we have this concept in Google, which I really like. It said, set very big, bold goals. Even if you achieve half of it, it is great. But let your ambition be really high. So sometimes we have this concept of OKR, which is objectives and key results. So you set for a quarterly goal or 2 quarters. If you don't achieve, don't consider it as a failure and say, yeah, here are the things I've learned. Maybe a timeline have to be shifted a little bit. So that's how I would ask. And then second is, if you don't achieve in a certain timeline, I wouldn't consider it as a failure. I think you've done a lot of things. Your journey teaches you a lot. And then later figure out, okay, let me figure out what is the right timeline for this. I think those are the two things I would say.
All right. Thank you so much. So we'll take one last question. We have a question from Nirvan. Nirvan is asking, can you please talk about one of your failures and how you overcame it? So we'll start with Sanjana. So Sanjana, I mean, can you talk about one of your failures and how you overcame it?
Yes. So what happened is, actually I had problems with, facing people. I couldn't talk. I was an extrovert, but then I turned to an introvert.
Oh.
There was a few factors which I became depressed, I would say, sad. Yeah. So how I overcame is that I understood the problem.
Yes.
I understood what was bothering me.
Mm.
Yeah, so I started working on those. Okay. So what bothers me the most? What should I be doing? What start doing? So, you know, I start waking up early. I start, you know, write my journal, being thankful, working on myself. I started procrastinating a lot with the problem. So I said to myself, talk to myself, you should stop it. Yeah, be active. Whatever things bother me, I work on it, I talk to people. So I thought of my own thing. So that would be something which, you know, I okay.
Yes.
Because my health and mental health started affecting my physical health. So
yes.
Yeah, I overcame that. So I'd say that would be one most important thing.
Very interesting. Yeah, so basically earlier you were an extrovert and then you turned to be an introvert. Now I think again you're extrovert, hence you are on the panel. So I think yes. So I mean, I'm really happy that you know, it has really helped you, Sanjana. And actually, you have overcome that. And also, I'm happy that you are very much confident now, because I've been seeing you in several platforms. You've been talking about your ideas to the people, and you've been hosting a lot of sessions also. So I'm really happy that you have overcome that. And I think there's a lot to go. So that is something that we will anyways discuss offline. I'm so happy for you. So Madhuri ma'am, I mean, your personal failure, anything that how you have overcome?
Just quickly, because in the interest of time, I came from a very lower middle class family, but I was really good at my academics. I was an introvert by nature. I was topper in my state, 10th topper in 10th grade, state 12th topper. So I got us admission in Bitspilani, but we had no money. So a lot of people gave me donations, including my own teacher. So it at least helped me for the first year. So I took a lot of donations, go to Pilani. And Pilani is a very new education. I mean, computer science, I have 70 kids. Everybody is the topper from their state, from Kashmir to Gujarat to Calcutta, and was intimidated for sure. But I did my best. Still, I didn't do extremely well. And that really made me think, look, I am always first in the class. I'm a topper in the state. Why can't I do this? I struggled. Then I figured out ways. But unfortunately, by the time I figured out, second semester, I had a bad lung infection and I couldn't write second semester exams. So I came home after 3 months. I recovered 3 months. Then I went 2 weeks early. They gave makeups. Makeups were very, very, very hard. And my grades really fell down. I was really at the bottom of my thing. Look, I studied well. With so many loans, I have come here. Now I'm sick. What do I do? I had to work on myself for, I think, a few months and weeks to tell, no, I'm not going to give up. I'm going to try hard. Yes. And here I am 22 years later. I've worked in 3 different continents, 2 big corporate giants and in a startup. All because at that point of time, neither lack of money nor health or some things has not stopped me. I relied a lot on parents, friends, ecosystem. So that's what I would say. Life throws hard things at you. But whatever I am today is what I learned during those couple of years where we were scouting for money to pay my fees every 6 months and how I bounced back from low grades to high grades. So that's my story.
Yes, yes. Very, very inspiring. And now I think Google is also saying that no degrees, there is a contradiction here. So I'll also talk about that maybe in separate forum. Definitely. I think this, I think this topic has to be extended. Definitely. We will set up another session for sure for all our audience. So Rupal ma'am, finally, I would like to get your quick insight on, is failure an option for anyone? And I wanted to know one final closing remark from you, one message to all the parents, principals, students, everyone from your perspective.
So I think, if everybody just remember that failure is, it is actually going to benefit the child. It's actually, yes. It is actually the path that is going to lead to that success. So the answer is not to avoid the failure or to a lot of parents are kind of, you know, wanting to protect their kids from failure, because obviously it's hard, right, to see your child going through something, you know they're going to fail. But some things, in fact, that time also to allow them, because, you know, experiencing, I think, you know, if you realize that experiencing failure is what is going to make you more resilient, it's going to give you that strength, and that is going to lead to success, you know. So very, very important that not to avoid failure, and to help the kids to face that failure head on, to challenge it, to reflect, and to grow from it. You know, not because sometimes when we say, okay, you failed, it's okay, don't worry. But the key is not to not worry. The key is, how do I use that failure as an opportunity for growth?
Yes, yes. Very interesting. I think there are lot many questions that are popping up. What I'll do is I'll just, share the questions with you offline, and we can give you our responses to everyone, because I think we are running out of time here. Once again, I thank all the panelists for answering the questions and also giving your insights. We have Colonel Shekhar sir also joined the session. Thank you so much, sir. I think he's giving very, he's telling that, you know, Ms. Madhuri well spoken, and also he's also talking about the book. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for joining the session. He is one of our advisors and also mentors. So he's also joined the session. Thank you. Disha, so if at all you can talk about, what's going to happen next week to all our viewers, and also if at all they can get access to this session, because I think it's a wonderful session. I think everyone should be watching this session. So if at all you can tell people on how to access this session, that would be great. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Pavan. And to all the viewers, whoever missed out the sessions and who want to watch it, you can surely go to the Facebook page of ours, which is Metamorphosis Edu, and access it. Or also onto the www.metamorphosisedu.school.com. So that's our website. And we'll all also share it over your emails. The recorded session will be shared over your emails. So once again to the panelists, thank you all for joining us today. I think that was a wonderful, wonderful session, and a couple of insights which have come on from our live portals that you learn from failure more than you learn from success, and also that failure builds a character. So this was a very sensitive topic that we've discussed today, and I'm really glad that we've had a parental perspective, a psychiatrist perspective, and also a child perspective. We're going to come in with a lot of such topics which are currently in today's generation, which parents, teachers, and students have been facing, and how they could solve this. And we'll give you insights. So we look forward to a lot of such sessions. I would just like to end this discussion with a quote, which is, losers quit when they fail, but winners always fail till they succeed. So thank you so much. So stay tuned and meet you all next week. Thank you,
Disha and Pavan. It's been a privilege and an honor to be part of this panel. And thank you, Pavan, and your entire team for, I think, really doing this for the next generation.
Thank you. It was fabulous.
I think everybody
shared so much from the heart. So wonderful.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Sanjana, don't worry about your 95%. It's okay. Enjoy your lockdown. All right. Stay safe, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.